event of ORS intellectual discourse. Before starting the event, I request all to recite Bismillah and Surah Fatiha. Discourse, we are looking forward to share beneficial knowledge and learn from those who have deeper understanding on various subject matters. So today our speaker will be Associate Professor Dr. Nakul Autabeta, and he will be sharing with us the topic of Islamic housing in Malaysia back to the humanistic agenda. I hope all of us will be benefited from this talk. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give barakah in our effort. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Dr. Nankula to share with us his presentation today. Thank you.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah ilazi arsala rasulahu bilhudah wa'inifah liyusibu wa'adhinikuni wa'atmabila syuhidah Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala Muhammad fil alam ayinatul khalilu wajib Wabi suruh sahbih wa sallamah. Dear lecturers, professor, associate professor, all the postgraduate students of ORS, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Very good morning. It's always difficult to start in the early months. That's why I keep telling my students, even you have two students, you will start at 9:30. So we are expecting lots of students will be coming, but most of the time they will be coming around 10. That was the normal times for them. So, because today is Friday, so I expect that we can finish before 12, so we won't be late for our Jumu'ah prayers. Because before this, the meeting of ORS always make us late for Jumu'ah prayers. So that will be not a very good activities like before. Okay. Today's I'll be talking about some things which was outside my field of expertise. Normally, when I give lectures, I will be talking about mosques and Islamic architectures. One day, I think around February or March 2004, we were invited by one of the developer associations in Kuala Lumpur to present our thought on the housings in Malaysia. So that was a presentation year back to 2004. And we are presenting what we thought to be the ideas of housings that we should propagate in Malaysia. A year after that, we are invited into another lectures, which was require us to present something to do with Islamic housings. So when we look back the presentation that we did in 2003, we look back that actually some of the issues was very well connected with what we are going to present as Islamic housings, because Islams present the ideas of goodness and good behavior and moral values. So what we did was we just take the presentation 2003 and put the hadith and some Quranic verse lah. And that presentation itself become the presentation of Islamic housings. So that was the histories of the presentations. And last time it was being represented again on the seminar, on the conference of Genius Lokai in Makassar, Indonesia, year back at 2013. During that time, we are presenting something to do with the housings in Southeast Asia. So I was presenting beside Dr. Associate Professor Dr. Kesu Kubota, one of my old friends, and Professor Godfrey Zaki in the type of Germany. So it has been represents and again and again. What I would like to highlight by telling you this history is that the ideas of Islamic houses, most of the time, it was not to say wrongly driven, it's just saying that it was derived from its original or its core problems, which was the problem of the people. Yeah, that was the thing that I would like to discuss today. What is the message that we try to deliver? As we have our city plannings and housings, we are designing in the ways that it become an investments, the ideas of machines living with us, without actually considering why we designed the housing in the first place. If you're referring to Corbusier's books of Versun architectures or towards architectures, he was giving the words mechanistic. Is the house is a machine for living in, for him, in the sense that it was his statement of how house can actually be treated as a machine to serve human beings. But the message of the housings, we're going to discuss a housing from the human perspective. That's why I bring back the housing back to the humanistic agenda. So let's discuss housing from the humanistic agenda and what we actually need in this housing. In this modern world, man has lost his soul, his self and God. And it's happened in the Western countries and in some of the Eastern countries. When we are losing our connection with our gods and our spiritual values. When we are discussing about housing, it talks about styles, it talks about how we can benefit or make money from it. So that was the issues. Sorry for the animation. So the city was actually made for men, because when we talk about housing, it brings up our understanding of the cities. That's why housing is a part of planning. Our city is made for men. Brick and mortars of the city are not the problem. So I was coming from the architecture background, where we are taught that everything can be solved by design. Yeah. I was having a discussion with my colleague friends, Professor Peter Zweilek from Eastern Universities. He said that we are always teach to be a person who can solve everything by design. But actually, the world is not only about designs. Yes, the design can give a huge contribution to the things, but there are lots of things which was actually very much affected outside the design itself. So the problems of the cities is always the problem of a man itself. So it doesn't mean that when we design a very well designed or nice cities, the man will change. But it will contribute into the changes of the environment. So that's why we need to understand what is actually the issues that related with the man. Okay? So if we look for the answers, we look at the design of the cities itself. Sometimes it's a miss. You're going to the wrong it's a wrong direction without understanding the true context of the man itself. Okay? Unless we understand the meaning of the families, the communities, society, a nation, and we understand cities from that understanding. So this presentation is trying to bring up the ideas that men should take into consideration their life, their their role in the communities and societies in relation to the God in these situations. So, as I said before, the city is not the problem. A man is always being the problem. Yeah? Modern cities, if you realize, I'm going to explain a little bit, because this is the fundamental message that I would like to deliver. Modern cities are made for the ease of machines to move products, for business to exchange, for personal statement of grandeur. Some people say they design a house so that they can make a statement that they are very rich people. They are very good people. Sometimes it becomes a machine to move for products, the housing itself. Yes. Modern cities were never designed for the entity called human beings. I will show you some evidence of that. If we're looking at the histories of the housings, so before the Industrial Revolution, housings was very much rely on individual commissions. So, for example, if I was a very rich person and I would like to have villas of my own, I would hire the architects. But one day, coming from nowhere, suddenly we have Industrial Revolution. Industrial Revolution is the times when we engage lots of workers, at the same time we make lots of factories. That's why if you read the histories of AEG turbine by Peter Behrens in Europe, you can find that actually during that time, architects never had any precedence on designing a factory. That's why Peter Behrens was designing the whole. It's not only the welcome Dr. Mazlan from UKM. I never expect that you're coming. So Peter Behrens was not only designing the factories, but also he was designing the whole logos at the same time the stationaries for that factories. That shows us that actually architects don't have any precedent in that time. Then when we have a reverse industries, we have to house our workers. That was the first time when people are bringing the idea of housings. Housing for the workers. That was the issues. Huh? So workers as the modern slave of industries need a house. Then it becomes something like that. But during the socialist development in Europe, then we have workers as a patriotic servant. Yeah, when we look at the clash of clan, the clash of the class during that time around the Europe between the bourgeois, the person who was very rich, the capitalism and socialism. Now we have new term called patriotic servants. Yeah. So we have now the house for workers. Now it's no longer a house to store pigeonhole to store the workers. Now become something patriotic. That's why if you see some design in the socialist countries, you will see that they design the workers as some sort of monuments to celebrate the heroes, the new heroes called the workers. When we go to the era of capitalistic feudalism, we look the housing as a capital, it's an asset. That's why if you read the books by Robert Kiyosaki or the Donald Trump's books, you can see that we can make lots of money from the housing stuff. So again, from these three stage of housing that we have. First, when you put the house as a pigeonhole for the workers, or when you put a house as a patriotic symbol of the workers with that time, or when you put a housing as a resources, as a places when we can generate money from it. So we are losing the original purpose of the housing itself, where it should be designed and built for the house, for the man, supposed to live there. This is what we have in Malaysia. Yeah? We saw that her housing is basically a parking lot for the families. So the families in the morning, early in the mornings, go out from your house, zoom, taking your cars, then you go to work. During afternoons, then you will coming back. When you will be working at Damansara areas, then you coming home around 7 or 8. Then you sleep there. It's like a parking lot for cars, but this is a parking lot for the families. Housing as a nobilistic investment properties. So you have a lot of, that's why the housing in Malaysia was very, very expensive. Because a lot of rich people who have a lot of money, they will invest the money in their houses. Because they believe that the price of housing won't go down at all. Then we have a housing without the reminders of humanity and centered values. That's why during the oldest time when we are living in the Malay village or so-called Chinese or Indian village, we have communities. But now with our current condition of housings in modern housings, we don't have the communities anymore. Because we coming from different background, different working area, now our communities become other things. Our community now is the community that we have in the Facebook, etc. It's no longer the community around us. Okay. So, just to brief through before I start the presentations, just to brief through that this presentation is trying to give not to say solutions, it's just to say that we might need to rethink from the socially and politically perspective, from the humanistic perspective, or we need to think about how the technology rediscover the formulas of ecological balance in order for that. So this is the summaries of the presentations. Any question before I start the presentation? That was the introductions. Any question? If we look in more details about the housings in Malaysia, we highlight, that's why it's a very so-called skeptical, so it's a pragmatic approach when we talk about housing in Malaysia. One is they call it the issues of unsafe environment for the children. So I'm going to show you that. We have the issue of criminal paradise in our housing in Malaysia. Now the burglar or the thief, when they want to enter your house, the best time was from 10 a.m. until 2 p.m. That was the best time. There's nobody in the house. They are no longer go inside your house during the night times. Yes, I happened to be meeting one of the professor in UKM. He was doing a research interviewing all this Banduan in English. It's somebody who domestic criminals who staying at the prison of Kajang, and he was interviewing them. Most of them is somebody who thief or go inside your house. So he was saying the best time now is 10 to 2 p.m. That was the best time. You have a luxurious time to take anything from the house. And the research shows a different type of approach, how you're going to enter the house. So that was a very good research, and it is very useful for architectures and maybe products or landscape architects. So I was hoping to he can share the knowledge, how actually people enter your house. Some of them is very simple. We like to have a green grass in front of the house, then you will bring the potong rumput. You cut the grass, then somebody look, oh, you are cutting the grass, and somebody else go inside the house. And then they were very happy to see the house when you have an aircon compressor in front of your house. So they will wear something like a technician for the aircon, and somebody go inside the house. So that was the issue of criminals there. Now, of course, we have the cultural and privacy violations issues, hot boxes, thermal comfort issues, sustainability is an issue of reminder life after. So there's two things is additional issues related with the Islamic housings. we just hear, I think 2 days ago, when a kid, I think 9 years old, fell down from the apartment, 20 stories apartment in Kuala Lumpur. And this is happening all the time. So one of my students, one of my diploma students, when I was teaching in a private college, do a research in Nilai and Negeri Sembilan. In Negeri Sembilan, especially on Seremban and Nilai areas. For the last 5 years, it is calculated they have like 50 to 80 cases in the last 5 years. So it's a big numbers. I was also surprised with the numbers, but this is the thing that happens. We have a low corridors when we do a surveys in Penang or some other research, the kids can easily take the benches, put here, and they climb the benches. And when I ask my 4 year student architecture in UTMs, whose fault is that? whose fault is that? Oh no, it's the authorities, they allow this height. Oh, it's the mistake of the parents. Doesn't take care of the kids. So I say, oh no, the parents and the authority never learn architecture. You are the one who never learn architecture. You'll be asked in the hereafters for that. So that was the discussion. So we have a dead towers, Muhammad Fikri's creation. Unsafe corridors, yes, falling for their deaths. In Islam, we refer to some hadith. You see how important to removal of what is injurious from the path and modesty is a very important. So, removing an injurious object is a very important in Islam. It's a part of faith. There's a lot of hadith talk about that. A person while walking along the path saw the branches of the tree lying there. He said, "Shall remove this?" Admitted to paradise. You see, Islam is not that difficult. So if you concern with other people, and as an architect, if you are designing something and that things save lots of person or kids, then it will become your barakas until hereafter. But if you are creating somebody, something who give who can bring a danger to lots of people, then the seed will come to you until the hereafter. So that was the problems as an architect. So this is some hadith that, as you can see. Because we are, as I mentioned before, we are required by the developers to present. So we give some basic solutions. Maybe you can extend the slabs a little bit. Maybe you can put a platter box there. It's a basic when the kids climb, at least they fall in these areas. So those are the simple, or maybe you can have some things like Moses Safdie's house, when you have a different floor plan. But the developer say, oh, this one is expensive. They don't want to deal with this one. So a simple alterations or modifications just to avoid is more for them is more appropriate. This is another case. When we have our planning for accidents, Siti Suzaini's coming back from religious schools, we have these our cities crisscross with the cars. So if you go back, even if you see the Sri Serdang's schools there, you go out from the school directly, so it's a public road. You can easily hit. So this is what happened with him. So he was permanently paralyzed because of that. Some cars hit him. So as an architect, so because this present is for that, we should think about it. The Greek zone and everything. We are living with the Greek zone. Designing with the Greeks. This is a scheme that we proposed a year back, 2004. Can we have our housing complex to be in one cluster's design? So we can have our shop lots, our apartments, terrace house, condominiums, kedai makan, restaurant, or schools in one clusters, in a very small clusters. And now we're having a lot of problems because our school now having a lot of students. One classes you can have like 50 students. And you have like 10 classes, 500 in one batch. You can imagine how many social problems that we face in our schools nowadays. So by engaging a very simple planning so that we can have a smaller communities here, I will show you the other design which try to bring the neighborhood's ideas. Like this one. So this is a housing complex in UTM, so one of my student UTM, so that we can have a smaller, and we are successfully showing to developer that the amount of the house that you can build is the same with our grid system. Because the problem now is that we have a grid system. We have a very big public space at center where nobody is using that. Why don't we have a smaller public space so that we can have a sense of belonging among the houses, the houses there. Our criminal paradise in our houses, back lane. Always an issue of back lane. First time I see the back lane is in Malaysia. We don't have back lane in Indonesia. I don't know why, but I believe it's because of the expensive lands. Maybe they don't have back lane. I know in Malaysia we have the issues of the fire. When you have a fire, how are you going to engage the bombers and everything? So, firefighters, it's very difficult to engage. But what happened when you didn't make use of it? Now, if you look for most of the houses, they put a fence here. They put a fence here, now become their own areas. They will plant trees there, they will put lots of activities there. Some of them move their kitchen here in my house's complex. So, what are you going to do with this one? But this one, if you didn't manage the back lane, now become a criminal paradise. Hidden and lonely. You can park your vans here, you climb up there, it's easily to go inside the house. So this is the issues that we need to discuss in very details now. You have a concentrated public space, designed for adoption. Sometimes you have kids playing here, everyone can come. It's very, for the whole housing complex, you have a very big one. Without eyes on the streets, anyone can easily do anything here. Because somebody is taking care of them. We have a very packed housing here. As a Muslims, if you hear something or you sense something, and you saw that the things is you should change it, whether with your hands or